Hello, I'm Dr. Shalini Yadav, Assistant Professor, University School of Education, GGSIP University, Delhi. Today we are going to discuss how do we create an inclusive school? What do you understand by the term inclusive school? In the last lecture, we had discussed what exactly do you mean by the term inclusive education. When you talk of inclusive education, I'm talking of an education in which a child or children, irrespective of their cultural backgrounds, irrespective of their disability, irrespective of their gender, irrespective of their caste, irrespective of their religion, irrespective of their race, irrespective of their region, etc., are in the class, they feel valued, they feel supported with reference to the teaching learning which is conducted in the class. So it is extremely important for us to understand, for any inclusive education, the school itself needs to be inclusive. So how do we create this inclusive school? Let us understand the creation of this inclusive school. As we all know, the primary responsibility of creation of a conducive teaching learning environment or creating an inclusive classroom rests with the teacher. Therefore, it is important that this role is clearly defined for the teacher. That means the teacher has to know what is expected of me in an inclusive classroom. There is a school which is inclusive. If it's a school which is inclusive, the in classrooms ought to be inclusive. Otherwise, naturally, we are not talking of inclusive education at all. So ultimately, the policy of the central or state governments is translated into action by a well-equipped and a well-motivated teacher. When I'm talking of a well-equipped and a well-motivated teacher, naturally, when I'm talking of well-equipped, it means the teacher is well equipped with reference to the knowledge of an inclusive classroom. The teacher is well equipped with reference to how to create this inclusive classroom. The teacher is well equipped with reference to the attitudes which the teacher needs to cater to this diversity in the classroom. And also the skills with reference to the usage of different assistive devices and when does the teacher need the support of different professionals in this regular classroom. All this, the teacher has to be well equipped. That means we are very clear on this, that the primary responsibility of creation of a conducive teaching learning environment with reference to an inclusive classroom rests with the teacher. That means we need to understand how this teacher creates this inclusive classroom, or how this teacher creates this teaching learning environment which is considered to be inclusive, or which is inclusive in letter and spirit. First and foremost, the teacher needs to be well equipped with reference to the use of teaching learning materials. How do I use the different teaching learning materials which are available? In order to cater to the needs of all children, it is important that the teacher strives to cater to different learning styles of learners. We all know that learners have different learning styles. That means, which are these chiefly, if you talk of, there are three learning styles which the learners have. The visual learning style, okay, the auditory learning style, and the kinesthetic learning style. That means, one, I may really like to learn with reference to the visual aids which are there. I may be very comfortable in learning through a chart, learning through a pictorial representation, learning through a picture composition, learning through a film, learning through a documentary, so on and so forth. Right? Or I may be very, very comfortable if I listen to something. So if you, you know, have a podcast for me, I would be very comfortable with that. On the other hand, there are some children who are very comfortable in learning when they engage with the material. You know, they are comfortable by learning by doing. They need to be engaged in the tasks and they learn the best that way. We are not saying which of the learning style is better. We are saying that children have different learning styles, and we need to cater to all those learning styles. When we say we need to cater to all those learning styles, it is very, very important for us to understand. That means we need this diversity of teaching learning materials with us to cater to these learning styles. Now, let us see which are these different teaching learning materials which the teachers can use. For example, in the case of visual materials, they can be in the form of pictures or photographs. Wherever appropriate, we can use. For example, it can be, I'm going to show you this also, it can be a picture of a jellyfish, or a Char Minar or a Taj Mahal or the Agra Fort or you name it, or the Jama Masjid, all these pictures or the photographs fascinate children. And especially when you're talking of subjects such as histories, you can have pictures of great personalities. You can have a picture or a photograph of Mother Teresa, Mahatma Gandhi, Swami Vivekanand, Sri Aurobindo, so on and so forth of different philosophers, different, for example, you can also, if you're teaching history, you may have Shah Jahan, you may have Akbar, you may have Chandragupta Maurya, so on and so forth. So once you show the children visual aids, they remember it more, right? And you can also show them pictures of rare plants and animals. You can show them pictures of ginkgo biloba. You can show them pictures of a emu. You can show them pictures of the two humped camel, which are there in Ladakh. You know, and children are very excited to see these pictures of rare plants and animals. We may not be able to show them in the rare plants and animals, but at least we can introduce them. You know, telling a child just the name of a rare plant and animal is very different. But when you show the picture, when you show the photograph, the children can identify that animal as well or the plant as well. And they understand what you're talking about. So, and similarly, photographs of historical places and events help children in developing their imagination. And it also makes learning more interesting and joyful. And once you make learning more interesting and joyful, it also becomes more meaningful for the children. So visually, the material which is there in visual mode is very, very important to engage the child in the teaching learning process. Now, and also to, of course, to cater to diversity of learning styles. Then you have tactual materials in the form of real objects or models, which make the concepts very clear. See, no amount of monotonous lecturing and not only a picture would explain the shape of the earth as effectively as a model. So if you take the model of the globe in the class, you can easily, you know, show the latitudes, the longitudes, you can show the different countries, you can show the different seas, you can also show the, you know, how it rotates on its axis. So it's very, very important. Models are also very, very important actual materials which the teacher may carry in the classroom. Similarly, if you're teaching mathematics, you may use three-dimensional geometric shapes such as the cube, the cuboid, the sphere, etc. And these figures are best understood in the form of models, right? Then tactual materials could also be real items. They are easily available, like, for example, all of us for that matter, up till class 10, when we study biology and when we are taught the structure of a flower, we are all very well versed that, you know, we have been introduced to the hibiscus flower. Okay, the hibiscus flower or the lily flower, to explain the structure of the flower. Remember your teacher dissecting each and every part and teaching you the different parts of the flower. So when you have the flower in your hand and you can see the different parts of the flower, you understand better because you're looking at, you're feeling the material in your hand. And for the same case, when you're talking of a banana, one is you're talking about the banana in a lecture and one you're carrying a banana with you. And you explain the qualities of this nutrition, energy giving fruit to all the children. So tactual materials also have a very, very important role with reference to making children learn and making their concepts very clear. And this can be done very easily if you look around in your immediate environment. Many a times, instead of, you know, going for teaching learning aids, which are expensive, cost-effective teaching learning aids can be made by the teacher himself and herself. And we can engage the learners better. Then when we are talking of the immediate learning environment, one is you tell them that there are different types of, plants. And the other is you take them to the field. You show them that these are the herbs, these are the shrubs, these are the trees, and then ask them to identify the different herbs, shrubs, trees, climbers, creepers, runners, and so on, with reference to the plants which are around them. Similarly, it is very, very important. Many of us have not visited a bank till we really start working. it is very, very important that children are taken or exposed to the different services which different places in our immediate environment render. For example, we have a post office, we have a cyber cafe, we have a police station for our security, we have, or you know, to take care of any kind of elements who may pose threat to the society, or we have a bank which takes care of our finances, right, from which we take out a deposit, or in which we credit our deposit also. How does a bank work? So students are to be taken to these places so that they in real life understand the working of this sector. Similarly, a doctor's clinic, what are the challenges which all these personnel face in real life? It is very, very important to clarify all this. Instead of, you know, just showing the picture of a bank or the picture of a post office, I think these are the places which are available everywhere and every nook and corner of the country and near a school itself. So it's important that you take the children to these places such that they understand the people working there and how they support us in rendering such important services. So our immediate environment is so rich with reference to the resources available for which we can use with reference to our teaching learning in a classroom. Then something which works very well are demonstrations. Demonstrations are also very, very important when you want to show a child how does some particular phenomena work and what are the cause and effect relationships of different phenomena, or how does a phenomena actually take place. These demonstrations can be done in the classrooms, and these demonstrations can also be done in the laboratories. We have the mathematics laboratory, we have the science laboratories, we have the language laboratories, we have the social science laboratories. All these laboratories need to be optimally and effectively utilized such that important concepts can be demonstrated to the students and they learn, right? And in this case, we can use low-cost teaching aids and teach them. For example, if it is a concept of the ascent of sap, right, you can have ink and you can have a straw, and you can show how the ink is percolating upwards for the ascent of sap in plants. Another very, very important thing, as you know, that these days the use of information communication technology, even, you know, when this lecture is being broadcast to you, it is through the use of information communication technology. So ICT no doubt has made teaching and learning more accessible on one hand and interesting on the other hand. There are e-books available and a number of e-books which are available for free downloads. And there are other resources also available online which support learning by the click of a mouse. On the other hand, there are numerous audio, video CDs, DVDs, short films and online resources which may be shown to students. For example, see, if you need to, in a biology lesson, for example, if you need to show the child the working of the vocal cords, for example, now when I'm delivering this lecture, my vocal cords are working. Now, what exactly is the movement of the vocal cords has to be shown to the students. The best aid for this is that you show an audio-visual CD to the child wherein the vocal cord movement is shown to them so that they understand that while we speak, this is the movement of the vocal cords, right? Now, it's very, very important that also we can use films to show the histories and the cultures of different civilizations, be it Mohenjo-Daro civilization, be it Harappan civilization, Indus Valley civilization, Mesopotamian civilization, so on and so forth, through short films, which can be very, very interesting for students. You know, instead of lectures, which many a times become monotonous. So to break the monotony of lectures, I'm not undermining the relevance of a lecture. But you know, when you use these different ICT tools, it makes the teaching learning of the teacher very interesting and effective on the other hand. So these short films and videos can be used to show them the different cultures, the different histories, the different environmental conditions across the globe, so on and so forth. Right. So, use of information communication technology is also very, very important when you are talking of creation of an inclusive school or inclusive classroom per se. Now, a very, very important part is use of ICT comes later, but we also need to take care of the physical environment, right? That means if a child is in school, right, the child has to feel comfortable inside the classroom. The place where the child is has to be suitable for the child in all respects, right? If a child in the school has a problem in moving from one place to another, the places may be changed to suit the needs of the child, which is very, very important. If there is a child who is facing any problem with reference to movement, there is a child who is orthopedically challenged. So we can have the classes where children who are facing any kind of physical challenge have the classes on the ground floor, such that they do not face any problem in their movement. So modifying the physical environment is also very, very important when I am talking of creation of an inclusive classroom. Now this modification, for example, we just discussed, the classroom for the upstairs may be changed to downstairs if a child has difficulty in climbing stairs. If the school does not have a lift or a ramp, which it should have, it's a multi-story, it is important, or even if it's a first floor and the child has difficulty in climbing up to the first floor, we need to have that classroom downstairs such that the child is comfortable, child or children for that matter. The classroom in the distant corner can be changed close to the main entrance so that the children do not find it difficult and do not take enormous time to reach their classroom. So these are very small things which need to be taken care of such that every child in my classroom is comfortable. When I am talking of this comfort of the child, it is very, very important that we take care of this comfort with reference to the physical environment. In this physical environment, the space inside the classroom is another very, very important aspect which we need to pay attention to. The arrangement of the furniture should not obstruct children to move inside. We cannot have a classroom which is full of furniture where children, you know, they are unable to move freely inside the classroom. The classroom has to be such that between the rows the children can move comfortably. There should also be places where the ground is free and you can have mats there where the children can sit and discuss. The seating arrangement has to be made considering the requirement of every child in your classroom. For example, a child having hearing impairment can be given the place in the first row, preferably in the center, such that the child does not face any challenge. For example, another case, a child who has a low vision should also be made to sit right in the front so that the child does not have any problem in looking at the blackboard or the chalkboard. Another very, very important thing is, a child requiring the teacher's attention has to be seated in a place which is easily accessible to the teacher as well. These are very, very important modifications in the physical environment which need to be taken care of when we are talking of creation of an inclusive classroom environment. For example, there may be a child who has difficulty seeing in bright light. So the child has to be seated in a place where direct light does not fall on the face of the child. Look at the extent of empathy which is required and how keen you are to be as an observer in the class, as a teacher, right? That means you have to maintain very carefully the cumulative record cards of the child, which have the details of every child, such that you can cater to the needs of every child in your classroom. Whether it's a child who has a hearing impairment, whether the child may be having a visual impairment, whether the child has an orthopedic impairment, whether it is a child who doesn't know the language. So you also need to make the child sit in a place such that there is a child who knows a similar language, or the teacher knows the language, such that language itself does not become a handicap for the child in learning. Then if we go further, a very, very important distraction and a very important source which proves to be a negative reinforcement in teaching learning is the noise inside and outside the classroom. This noise inside and outside the classroom has to be controlled. A student getting distracted easily, there are many children who may be having attention deficit, There may be children who are very easily distracted. There may be children who are hyperactive, so on and so forth. So when you know that the child gets easily distracted, the teacher has to ensure that the child is given a place away from the corridor, window or door, such that the child is able to concentrate while the teaching learning is going on in the classroom. Then the noise making furniture should be also fitted with some rubber bush, which is very, very important. Because if the teacher is teaching and when a child is writing and the furniture is making noise, this can also prove to be a very big distraction for the children. It is also very, very important that as much as possible, natural light and air has to be utilized. Fans and light disturb some children. You know, if they're constantly there is a noise coming from the rotation of the fan, it's very, very important that you plug it. Another thing which has been seen to pose as a disturbance inside the classroom is you have the charts fixed, and when the fan is moving or circulating the air, you know, these charts start flipping to and fro, and this creates unnecessary noise which needs to be controlled. But you can stick them by the tape on the wall such that this unnecessary noise is avoided. So it's also very, very important for us to understand that we need to ensure that the surroundings are clean and well organized. Our role as teachers is vital in maintaining this. On rotation, children can take the responsibility of cleaning and arranging the classroom. I'm not saying virtually cleaning the classroom, but at least not littering the classroom. It has to be ensured, because they also have to ensure and take responsibility that they do not litter their immediate environment. Wall hangings and charts must be displayed with appropriate planning of spaces available, keeping the aesthetics in mind, right? The cleanliness and orderliness of the room prepares the students to learn. When we say creation of an enriched teaching learning environment, which is inclusive in nature, it is very, very important that the surrounding is clean, the surrounding is well organized, the charts are there at the right position, the charts have bold letterings, the visuals are clearly visible to all students of the classroom, and they are aesthetic, such that the child feels motivated to come inside the classroom. It is very, very important for the child to feel comfortable and motivated to enter this classroom. Now, when you talk of this, there are some certain simple techniques which we have to see for adapting the classroom environment. When the children with diverse needs are in one room, we have to be prepared to overcome all these challenges. Right, but this can be done very easily if we employ certain simple classroom management techniques. Now, these simple classroom management techniques are such that, for example, we discussed the physical infrastructure, right? That you have comfortable furniture, you have space such that the child moves in the classroom comfortably. You have to ensure that the teacher is prepared with reference to the teaching learning materials. You have to be very sure that the classroom is clean, right, and you are catering to the diverse needs of all the children. Now, this classroom management gets refined with the experience of the teacher. With very little time and effort, many of the day-to-day difficulties can be handled. All it requires is our love and faith in all children in the class. Now, when you say this, this also includes, apart from the physical environment, it also includes employing child-friendly evaluation system. The rigid evaluation system is not practical in an inclusive classroom. You cannot have an evaluation system which is very rigid in nature. It is extremely important for you that the evaluation should assess what the child is able to do rather than what the child is not able to do. We shall see how it can be addressed in the classroom by teachers such that it suits the needs of every child in the classroom. The teacher has to ensure that the evaluation is flexible. There are different learning assessment techniques used such that every child's need in the classroom are catered to. Now, some children may not be able to learn any basic academic skills, but they may be very, very good in some different areas. So we have to also see that we compensate the child by assessing the child in these different areas. It is to assess the child's skills in vocational areas or self-care, depending on the individual, it has to be taken care of. If we take the freedom to evaluate the child on the basis of our understanding of the child, the school is a beautiful place. The horror of the tests and the exams will cease to haunt the child. Now, it is also very, very important. Just see this picture. When you look at this picture of the jellyfish, how happy do you feel? Talking about the jellyfish, lecturing about the jellyfish is something different. But looking at this picture live, or looking at the jellyfish live, gives you a different kind of experience. Now look at these penguins together, right? These penguins together, the sheer joy which a child gets on looking at these pictures is very, very important in any teaching learning space. We need to use visuals. We need to use photographs. That is also visual. We need to give them tasks in such that they are engaged in learning together. We need to also enable such that they have tasks wherein they speak. There are tasks wherein they dramatize. There are tasks wherein they engage in role plays, wherein they recite, wherein they listen. So once you have a diversity of teaching learning tasks, using a diversity of teaching learning materials, catering to different children in the classroom through the support of different professionals, such as speech therapists, such as language therapists, such as, for example, counselors, for example, audiologists, then only we can say, yes, this classroom environment is inclusive in nature. So it's very, very important for us to understand that the onus of responsibility for creation of a teaching learning environment, which is inclusive, rests with the teacher. This can be done by the teacher being prepared in the usage of teaching learning environment, by the teacher ensuring that the physical environment in which the child is placed is comfortable for the child. And also, it is very, very important that this physical learning environment has ample space for the child to move about. And this classroom also caters to the diversity of learning styles of different learners. We are catering to the diversity of learning styles on one hand, and therefore, we also have to use different learning evaluation techniques, assessment techniques, so that we evaluate different learners depending upon what is their learning style. Once this is done, I'm sure that we will be able to create a teaching learning environment which is inclusive in nature. So, in the end, I urge each one of you to strive to create this inclusive teaching learning environment in the classroom such that every child feels motivated to come to the class and every child is an active participant in the process of learning. Every child learns to learn together. Every child's pace of learning is taken care of and the teacher and the taught function as mentors and mentees in this teaching learning process. I hope you have well understood how to create an inclusive classroom in today's lecture. Wish you all the very best and may we all together strive to create this inclusive classroom in all our schools. Thank you very much.